school teachers. I thank and praise and amen for my wife, amen, who's always by my side, amen, who's always speaking words of encouragement to me. I appreciate, amen. I say again, amen, almost 25 years, and I thank and praise God for her. Will I do it all again? Of course I will, no doubt in my mind, because I know, amen, who she is and where she came from. Amen, I know what her background is, amen. But I thank and praise God, I'm telling you, it's a blessing, brothers, to have a saved wife. Amen. If you got one, amen, treasure her. Amen. Glory be to God, because God is a good God. Again, amen, I just want to talk to us this morning a little bit, amen, about the Apostle Peter, these scriptures here. Oftentimes we hear somebody always say, you don't know how I got here. You don't know my testimony. You don't know my story. And that might be true, but God, amen, requires of us that we have a testimony, amen, that is pleasing unto him. The world, praise our God, is going to hate you because Jesus said they're going to hate you because it hated me first. So when you stand on God's word, amen, the enemy of your soul is trying to, amen, stop you, amen, from having a testimony, both verbally, amen, and with those that somebody can hear, and those, amen, that those can see, because whether we realize it or not, the only God sometimes that people are going to see is the one, amen, that you're living. So my title for today, amen, is Jesus, my reason of hope. Jesus, my reason of hope. And that's what Peter was trying to get them to understand. It says, you got to be ready, amen, to give an answer for those, amen, for the hope that lies within you. In other words, when the world is going through, the question began to ask, why are you not so, amen, fluttered and moved, amen? Because I'm hoping in God. And I realize that the word of God standeth true. A lot of times, amen, this season now that the world is in, for high school students, they begin to choose colleges, amen. They begin to start looking at colleges and find out what kind of degree that they want their education to be in. But one of the most important things that we always give advice is that you as a saint, as a child, amen, that's going into this education or the college system, you got to make sure that whatever you're going in is having accreditation. You say, well, accreditation, amen. And all accreditation is the acceptable level of what quality is. In other words, if I'm going to a university, amen, that has a nursing program and I find out that it's not accredited, then I'm going there for 4 years, amen, wasting my time. Because when I go out and try to apply for a job in the real world, the first thing they want to look at is an accreditation. Sometimes, amen, you've seen schools lose their accreditation because when those children or when those young kids have went through 4 years of education, whether it be nursing or whatever you want to have it, amen, and when they get there, amen, they cannot perform. And so there's a time, amen, that begins to look at and says, we have lost our accreditation because we said we'd given this diploma, but when they get out into the real world, they cannot perform. And so as saints of God, our accreditation is in Christ Jesus. And that's what we begin to realize that Peter's saying is that my accreditation is in Christ Jesus, because I've seen him, I've been an eyewitness of his resurrection. I know what he was able to do, and my accreditation is in Christ. In other words, I can perform the things, amen, by the help of God, those things that I need to do, amen. So verse number 14 says, you are blessed if you suffer for the sake of righteousness. Now, most of us, amen, when we begin to talk about suffering, amen, or being blessed, we equate that, amen, with being suffering, amen. But listen, in the 1 Peter, the 4th chapter, verse 14, it says, if you be reproached for the name of Christ, he says, happy are you. He said, for the spirit of the glory and of God rests upon you. On their part, he is evil spoken of. He said, but on your part, is he glorified. He's telling us, amen, that as we go through this life, saints of God, as we go through, amen, day-to-day activities, amen, we stand up for what we believe in, amen, we're going to be persecuted. But what we got to realize, amen, that this persecution, amen, really is a merit badge, amen. It's a badge of merit. You can wear this persecution badge proudly, because you're doing it for the sake of Christ. He said, but when you're doing it, amen, not for the sake of Christ, then it's a merit badge of dishonor. So we understand when he began to talk about the Beatitudes, amen, the 5th chapter of Matthew, he said, blessed, amen, to be blessed. It's a privilege, amen, to suffer for the name of Christ. People are taken down, amen, because they're afraid, amen, to be ostracized, to be cast out because of the name of Jesus. So saints, we don't have to be afraid afraid, amen, of what men can do. We got to be, amen, be fearful that who can do what, who can harm the body and the soul. So when we begin to think about this thing here in Matthew, the 10th chapter, verse number 28, he says, fear not them that can kill the body. He says, but are able to kill both the soul, but rather fear them which is able to destroy both the soul and the body in hell. And so in other words, there's a time going to come, saints of God, that we got to make a choice. It says, for Christ I live and for Christ I die. And so when we realize those words, we have to count the cost. But God's now those times are really coming upon us. Those times, amen, are now, amen, they're vastly approaching that the saint of God has got to make up in his mind that says, I'm going to serve God. And so Peter began to encourage the saints of God, amen, to fear God rather than man. And so we remember who Peter is. We remember, amen, it's that disciple, amen, that denied Christ three times. Remember him, amen, when he should have been encouraging the brothers, amen. He went about fishing. We remember him, amen, because when he was sitting with the Gentiles, amen, and when the Jews come, he would get up. This is the same, amen, Peter that Paul rebuked face to face about doing those things, but he got to understand something. Even in going through those things, saints of God, we got to realize, amen, that what I'm going through, amen, is for the glory of God. It says, Jesus, hallelujah, is my reason of hope. And so sometimes, amen, the enemy wants you to think that all hope is lost, but I serve a risen Savior who was death, burial, and resurrection. Because of that, amen, I can face, amen, any situation, whether it's right now or whether looking down the road, I can face my tomorrow because Christ lived. Not because he just got up, because he liveth in me through the power of the Holy Ghost. And one of the best ways, saints of God, to overcome the fear of persecution is to go through. And sometimes, glory be to God, we realize, amen, that somebody might have a fear of heights. And so, amen, the best way to conquer that fear is to get to a level, amen, not go to the top all at once, because that's going to cause you, my God, not to want to go up at all. But when you begin to take those steps, amen, and understand what the goal is, amen, to overcome fear. The goal is to overcome height, that my God. And so as I begin to take steps, I get a little higher. I look down and say, okay, this is not bad as I thought it was. But I get a little higher, amen. But the enemy is going to start speaking to you and say, listen, if you fall, you're going to hurt yourself. But we got to realize, glory be to God, that God will keep us from falling if we lean on him. And so I step a little higher in the ladder. And before I begin to realize, I have to go up to a certain point every time and go up to that point and stop. Go up to that point and come back down to overcome a certain spirit of fear. And then I can get to the top of the ladder. Not only just get to the top, but I can look down now. Glory be to God. And so is the enemy of our soul. He wants not even to take that first step because we're too busy looking up at the top. But look at the situation that you're now in and say, God is, he'll keep me from falling. He will not give us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. So as I begin to do this thing, I begin to feel the presence of God. I begin to have that peace of God that surpasses all understanding. Yes. That blessing is from God and not from man. The enemy wants you to fear, amen. He wants you to fear what's beholding you tomorrow. But when you think about what God is doing for you now, he gives the strength to overcome those things, what's befalling you. So saints of God, don't allow the adversary to come in and to steal your joy. The fact that we live in this world and there's so many people that don't believe this man called Jesus. They don't believe in believing, amen, in baptism. They don't believe in being filled with the Holy Ghost. They don't believe in feeling, amen, living a holy and sanctified life. As a matter of fact, the prince of this world has blinded their minds so they cannot see. But I want you to understand something. When you're persecuted for Christ's sake, you got to count it a privilege. He said, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations. My reason for hope is Jesus Christ. My reason, amen, for having a joy unspeakable is because Christ, amen. My reason, amen, for being able to praise God in the midst of trouble because I hope, amen, in God. And now this word, praise be to God, it talks about reason. Let me tell you what reason really is. The dictionary says it's a statement or a fact. fact that explain why something is the way it is. And so why do they praise God the way they do? There's a reason behind, amen, the way they praise him. That's the testimony behind why I praise him like I do. And he goes on to say, he says something of why someone behaves a certain way. I act this way, amen, because God has brought me from a mighty long way. You act like you lost your mind. I have lost my mind. I lost it in Jesus Christ. I lost my mind because the mind that I have, when I would do good, evil was always with me. But when I put on the mind of Christ, I put on the mind, and I said, I cannot make provision for this flesh. This is why, amen, he said, the reason my hope, the reason the way we praise and the way we do, because God has done so much for us. This breath that we breathe is because of what God has done. I thank God, amen, for saving me out of the muck and the mire. I was a sinner, wretch, undone. My God, but he saw fit to save me. He looked through the ends of time and saw, old Todd, he said, listen, that brother needs to be saved. But the only way he can be saved is I got to stop him in his track. I got to go against, amen, that thing that he holds near and dear to his heart. He thought he could rap, my God. He thought he could persuade. But when I stand him against the word of God, he had no power. And so, saints of God, this is what I'm trying to get the saints to understand. The enemy, my God, when he come against you, you cannot use your own words, but you gotta use the words of God. And that's why he said, my God, he said, man should not live by bread alone, but every word that proceed out of the mouth of God. And that's why he said, when you hide it in your hearts, that you might not sin. It's not talking about you going and practicing. He's talking about when you hide it in your heart, when the enemy comes in to try to steal that word, you got something, my God, to stand against the wiles of the devil. Your reward, saints of God, is in heaven, and it shall not be lost. Why, amen? Because it's eternal, and our eternal God is a God that came down 40 and two generations that we might have a right to the tree of life. But however, when you're persecuted, when you're going through, when it seems like, amen, everything, amen, is falling beside you, your children, amen, your wife, your family, your job, can you still have a hope, amen? Can you still realize that God, he will supply your every need? It means, amen, listen, the thing that the enemy wants you to do, he wants you to lose faith and confidence in God. And that's why he said, put no confidence in your flesh, but all our confidence has to be in God. And then the enemy says this thing, listen, the gospel is an offense. Yes, it is. It offends people. If it offends people, what about the devil? The gospel, amen, will put the devil on the run. But you gotta have the word of God down in your inside. You gotta have it somewhere that when you need a word from the Lord, you're not on your phone trying to call somebody and say, I need a word from God. You can flip through the word of God that's been hidden in your heart. And sometimes when you begin to encourage yourself, you begin to take some confidence and say, I can do this thing. I can, amen, stand for what I believe in. And that's what we begin to look at in the 15th chapter of St. Matthew. Glory be to God. That was a situation with the disciples here. You're going to have to turn there because I want you to understand something. What God was beginning to tell them. Let's turn to Matthew, the 15th chapter. It's a very important thing for the saints of God to look into the word of God and say, what does the word say? How did God deal with the situation? He dealt with it, amen, from a standpoint. He said, I am the true and living God. He said, listen, at verse number 1 said, then came Jesus. Listen, they came to Jesus, scribes and Pharisees, which were Jerusalem, saying, he said, why did your disciples transgress the tradition of elders? Why are they walking against what we've been teaching all this time? Listen what he says. He said, they don't wash, my God, their hands when they eat bread. But Jesus says, he said, why do you transgress the commandment of God by your traditions? And so what God began to tell them, he said, you're transgressing the law of God by the very things that you do. So saints of God, sometimes people are doing things contrary to the will of God because they begin to follow traditions. He said, for God commanded, said, honor thy father and thy mother, my God. He said, honor them. But what they began to say, he said, I can't do this because because I want to glorify and bless God. So therefore, I want to give to God what I would give to my family. But he said, you're not even doing that. So therefore, my God, you're not honoring me. But he skips on down here. Listen what he says in verse number 8. He said, this people draw nigh unto me, but with their mouths, they honor me with their lips. But listen what he says, but their hearts are far from me. People begin to bless the Lord at all times, but their hearts are far from him. He said, but in vain, my God, do they worship me. He said, teaching for doctrines the commandment of men. In other words, they're teaching what they want to teach and not the understanding of what I'm saying. He said, I didn't come to destroy this law, but I came to fulfill it. But listen, it gets down to the meat of this thing. And he called the multitude and said, you got to hear and you got to understand. A lot of people are hearing, but they don't have an understanding of what God requires of them. Jesus, my God, Jesus is the reason of my hope that lies within me. That's why I praise him the way I do, because of what he brought me from. And then here's the kicker, verse number 12. Listen what he says. He said, then came his disciples and said to him, knowest thou, the Pharisees were offended. They were offended for what you just said. They was offended because you went against their traditions. They was offended because the thing that you were teaching, it seems like you brought them to the forefront and you exposed them for who they were. As a matter of fact, he called them hypocrites. Yes, he did. He said, let them alone. He said, every plant, my God, which heavenly Father hath planted, shall be rooted up. So saints of God, this word of God is going to offend. But don't you be the offense. Let the word of God do the offending. And sometimes create venture by that offense, my God. The word of God draws them in. And so this is why Jesus could always say, and this is why Peter was there. He'd been with him for 3.5 years. It said the disciples brought Jesus. Can you understand something? They're looking at my God, the individuals, they look at their body language, and they say, Lord, you offended them back there. But God said, listen, if I offend them, it's because of traditions of men and not the will of God. So saints of God, make up in your mind, you're going to have a will to follow Jesus all the way. And listen, let's go back to 1 Peter, the 3rd chapter, verse number 15. He said, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that seeketh the reason of the hope that's in you, with meekness and with fear. In other words, don't be boastful about it and say, I'm saved, sanctified. You got to break down the word of God to him. You got to talk to him with some meekness. And that's why God said, with love and kindness have I drawn them. In other words, if I don't testify, if I don't speak of God's goodness, it's a godly reference. I got to speak those things that I've both seen and heard. I got to speak what I've been taught. I've been taught the word of God. He said, put on Christ in your hearts. And that's why men are failing. They're failing God in their hearts. They're fearing what man can do. And so therefore, listen, you got to love God more than you do the world. You got to love God more than you do criticism. You got to love God more than your necessary food. I'll never forget, and it keeps ringing in my mind, when Pastor Baker said, if mother don't go, still got to go. If wife don't go, got to go. If children don't want to go, I still got to go. I got to follow this man who brought me out of darkness into his marvelous light, and his name is Jesus. Therefore, if I don't know the word for myself, how can I give the reason of the hope that lies within me? The hope, my God, is in Jesus Christ. The hope that I have is eternal life. The hope that I have, I begin to look back over my life and realize what God brought me from. He said he brought me from a mighty long way. What are you saying? The long way. Yes, I was in sin. But through those times when I came to my senses and realized I needed a Savior, it's been a long time that he brought me. He has kept me through the power of the Holy Ghost. And that's why the songwriter says, I love this song. He said, my hope is built on nothing less. Listen, than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. People don't want to talk about the blood, but it's the blood of Jesus that cleanses me. It's the blood of Jesus that washed away my sins. Nothing but the blood. Nothing. He said, I dare not trust the sweetest frame, my God, but hold and lean on people. Some people are leaning on finances. Some people are leaning on their husband. Some people are leaning on their circumstances. But I'm leaning on the name of Jesus. He said the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous, they run into it, and they are safe. He said on Christ, the solid rock I stand, but all of the ground is sinking sand. How do I know? Because he went to the cross, my God, and he hung there between heaven and earth. And when they begin to ask him, come down, he said, save yourself. And they begin to mock him. They said, listen, he saved others, but he cannot save himself. We talked about this morning, but love kept him on this cross, because while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. If God had stepped down off that cross, we would be still in our sins. Somebody need to tell the Lord, I thank you, Lord, for what you've done. I thank you for being a great, big, wonderful God in my life. But I want you to know something, saints of God. What Paul began to tell Titus, he said, avoid foolish questions that don't lead to anything. But the question that leads to salvation, those are the questions that you got to entertain. Glory be to God. How many had to entertain some foolish questions? But when I think about what God has done for me, there's no entertaining foolishness. But I entertain those that have a sincere heart that want to know this man called Jesus. You got to understand that the reason, the hope that lies within you is because of what Christ did on Calvary. There's a time here I'm beginning to talk about. It's this man. His name is Peter. He is, amen, the subject of this story on this morning. He is the centerpiece. But when you realize he just didn't get there any old kind of way, he got there because the adversary was being to buffet him. He got there because of what God did for him. And so now, when I think of the goodness of Jesus, when I break this down, when God began to show me this thing, I begin to realize something. Listen, as the apostles, my God, and they begin to go out and do the great commission, there were some obstacles that were before their way, but that's what he told them. He said, Peter, Simon, Simon, he said, the same that desired to sift you as wheat, just on last week we said, he said, but I prayed for you that your faith fail not. And so, saints of God, we're praying for the saints of God that are staggering, that their faith in Christ Jesus does not fail, because by trusting anything else, it's going to go down. It's a sinking sand. And so, therefore, when you look into the Word of God once again, listen, I know that we're going through a lot of things. The enemy of your soul, he think he has you. As a matter of fact, when Paul was in that Roman prison, he was up there. He said, I might be bound in the flesh. He said, but the Word of God is not bound. And so I always say this, while I'm going through, still speak life. Yeah, I got some trouble in the home, but I still speak life, because the enemy here is trying to bind the Word, because it's causing problems in your life. And that's why you got to think about the goodness of Jesus. You got to understand who it is that called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Bear with me for a few more minutes. I want to tell you something. Peter just didn't get here just by circumstance. He got here because he trusted in God. He got here, glory be to God, because of what God did for him. Let's go ahead and do something here. Let's go ahead, my God. Let's go and turn to the 5th chapter of Acts, because there's something in here that's going to help the saints of God to ministry, because next week is coming. The enemy, my God, he's not glad that you're in the house of God. He's upset, amen, because you came here and you praise God. He said, you're going to lift up holy hands, but I'm going to bring something to you. But listen what begins to happen. Listen what I'm saying. Listen, verse number 13. He said, and the rest joined himself unto them, but the people magnified them, and the believer added to the Lord multitude, both men and women. He said, such that they brought forth in the street. Listen, now listen what I'm saying. He said, they laid them on beds and couches, that the least shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow them. What is God is saying? He said, listen, that's why he said, you got to be willing to give the reason of the hope that lies in you. In other words, I'm suffering persecution, but when I think back in my mind, I remember people bringing people on bears and garnets, just hoping that the shadow of me might pass, but it's not me. It's the Christ that's on the inside. My God, he said, came also multitudes out of the cities round about to Jerusalem, bringing sick folk with them. They were vexed with unclean spirits. He said, and they were healed, every one of them. And this is what we're saying, saints of God. You've got the power of God down the inside of you. You've got the power to speak life. Life and death is in the power of the tongue. Be willing to give the reason of the hope that lies within you. And that's why Peter could say this in his 1 Peter 3rd chapter, because in his life, the thing that happened to him back then, it's the power of God that rests on the inside. Listen what they say. Then the high priest, my God, he began to rise up with them, and the sect of the Sadducees were filled with indignation. In other words, saints of God, the enemy gonna get mad at you. Yes, he is. He's gonna get mad at you for bringing somebody to church. He's gonna get mad at you for being a witness for the Lord. My God, as long as you're not edifying God, he's gonna leave alone. But once you begin to step out on faith, then he's going to rise up against the people of God. Listen at this. It begins to say, and they laid their hands on him, and they put them into a common prison. The enemy's brother Gibbs, he wants to lay hands on you. And sometimes, saints of God, he will lay hands on you, but he cannot do it without the permission of God. But so they begin to put him in a prison. This is an important thing. Somebody said, verse number 19, but the angel of the Lord by night, he opened the prison doors and brought them forth. I'm telling you what God can do. He'll fight your battle, but you got to be in the right relationship. He said, you got to have a mindset and only cast me in into an inner prison. The word of God is not bound, because I can pray unto God, and God will, he will deliver me. Not why I'm having a pity party, but while I'm praising, I say, God, I might be bound in this common prison with these common folks, but when you seek God, a broken heart and a contrite spirit, will you know why to despise? Listen, saints of God, on the inside of you is the power of the Holy Ghost to summon heaven, and God will send an angel, my God, and sometimes an angel is nothing but another saint of God that's calling on you. Sometimes it's when they call you and say, I got a word for you, I got a scripture for you, I got a song for you. It's an angel from the Lord. So we begin to ask ourselves, that's why he said, neglect not to assemble yourself together as a matter of some is, because when I come to the house of God, sometimes all it takes is a big old hug and say, I love you on this morning. And somebody said, that's all I need to get me through of all I've been through. The saint of God, you don't realize what you have, and that's what the enemy, he wants to do, stop your testimony. Listen what he says. He said, and go and stand and speak the temple, the words, my God, of this life. He said, go stand. Don't go hide in a corner, but I want you out in the open. I want you to go somewhere where the people can see and look what God has done. They have broken him out of prison. And so listen, they didn't tell him go down on the run. They told him remain in the city where you are. As a matter of fact, go to the temple and begin to preach the words of eternal life. And listen what he begins to say. Glory be to God. And when they heard that, when they heard the word, hallelujah, when you hear the word, how many hear the word on this morning? He said, when they heard that, they entered to the temple. It was early in the morning. It was early in the morning. Early in the morning when I seek him. He said, and they talked this thing. And listen, but the high priest came and they went him. He said, call the council together, all the senate of the children of Israel, and sent to the prisoner to have them brought. The enemy of your soul is plotting against you. He getting all his imps together and say, go down there to so-and-so house. Let's go deal with them. But what the enemy does not realize, you've already been set free by the power of the Holy Ghost. They're plotting against you, but you got the oil for mourning. You got, my God, the spirit, the government of praise
for the spirit of heaven. You already got it on because you've been set free through the power of the Holy Ghost. While he's plotting, you're praising. While he's singing against you, you're shouting victory in the name of Jesus. And listen what he begins to say. Listen, and when the officers came, they found them not in prison. They returned and told the enemy looking, I had him in a corner speaking. I had him, my God, crawled up in their bed, suffering from depression. I had them, my God. But what happened when I went and thought they wouldn't be in that same corner just where I left them? I began to realize they're not there. Glory be to God. He said, listen, the prison truly was found shut with all safety, and the keepers, they were standing without before the doors. Listen what I'm saying. God will make your enemy look like a fool because they're standing there guarding somebody who ain't even there anymore. This is what God will do for you. He will guard your heart. He'll keep your mind in perfect peace. If you keep it staying on you, the enemy think he got you bound, but you're praising him. The enemy think, my God, that's a spirit of fear, but you're praising God. He'll have the enemy think that he got you against the wall, but when he come back and check on you, he said, I don't even see him. What happened? I thought I had everything in order. They was guarding something, looking for somebody who wasn't even there. Your situation is not even there. You're not dwelling in that place anymore because God has set you free. How many are free on this morning? He said, whom the Son set free is free in me. I'm free on this morning. I'm free because of what God can do. He said, when it had opened, they found no man in it. When God opened the door, listen, he opened the door and he let them out. They begin to walk into the temple, but the people that God had no idea of what was going on. Listen, saints of God, when you get into a situation, you start praising and blessing God. That's what it says. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise should continually be in my mouth. I'm in a prison, but my praise is still about God. The enemy has no clue that I'm gone. The enemy has no idea that I've escaped. The enemy has no idea that I'm free. Praise the Lord. I'm free. No more chains holding me. I'm free, my God. Even when the high priest came to the capital of the temple, the priest heard these things and they doubted where this thing is going to grow. Oh, don't let people get worried of what's going on because these men have already begin to turn the city upside down when they begin to understand. He said, listen, all you've been through, you mean to tell me you still can praise God? Yes, I can. You mean to tell me all that you're in right now, you still can praise God? Yes, I can. But why? Because Jesus, my reason of hope, that's why I hope in God, because of what my past experience has taught me. Listen, sometimes I know some people are always looking back on the bad in their life, but I'm telling you, when you look back over your life and begin to realize the source of when I think things over, glory be to God. Saints of God, you got to start thinking things over. God brought you through it. Yes, he did. It was the angel of the Lord that was standing by your bedside when you went to bed, wasn't feeling well, when you woke up this morning, didn't realize, but somewhere along the ninth hour, God has touched your body. Yes, he did. Thank you for touching me. Thank you for giving me a new life. They said you wasn't going to be anything. Boy, you're not going to be nothing. Glory be to God. Those are words that men speak. But when God looked over my life, I can use him. Oh, but he persecuted the church above measure. But I can use him. He cursed like a sailor. But I can use him. My God. And ran women like crazy. But I can use him. Because men look on the outside. God receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, he's going to rise up walking in the newness of life. I will put a new tongue in him. He'll begin to speak life and not cursing. He'll begin to change. He'll treat his family right. In other words, he'll correct the wrongs that he made. He'll have a new life that can only be found in me. Let's skip on down. My God, verse number 28, he said, did we not straight command you not to teach in his name? My God, listen what they say. We told you not to teach in his name. That's what the problem is. You fill this whole house, this whole city with your doctrine. He said, I can only teach something that I've been taught myself. He said, listen, you intend to bring this man blood on us, and now they begin to fear. He said, listen, in other words, you're talking about this man called Jesus. If you're not careful, we're going to be the one that lose our lives. But listen what he says here. He said, listen, and then Peter, he began to tell him, the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. Somebody have a problem with that, because I'm going to obey God rather than men. When men tend to do things that are contrary to God, you obey men. That's why the words obey those that have the rule over you. In other words, as they speak life, as they speak the doctrine of Jesus, then you obey them. And that's where Paul begins to say, follow me as I follow Christ. And so therefore, they begin to understand, even in the midst, because there's something else that went on in this conversation. There was a man called Thaddeus. He had 4,000 men that was following him. But thank be to God that a man named Gamaliel is the same one that Paul sat at the feet of him. He said, listen here, young men. Listen here, counselor. He said, remember not too long ago, there was one that brought up among this thing, Thaddeus. He said, listen, he began to preach this thing. He began to teach. He had 400 men following him at one time. But when he lost his life, when he died, they scattered. This thing dispersed. He said, listen, I'll remind you one more time. There's a man named Judas from Galilee came down preaching and teaching about taxes and all that good thing. He had men that was following him. Yes, he did. But glory be to God, when he lost his life, guess what happened? They began to disperse. Glory be to God. And that's why when Peter began to speak of the reason of hope that relies in him, their Savior, the one that had taught them for 3.5 years, my God, something happened. You know the story. He was crucified. My God, he was buried. And on the third day, he rose again, declaring all power in his life. My God, listen to what I'm saying. This is very important. He said, we are eyewitnesses of these things. Listen, these 400 men, they scattered and dispersed because things were still dead. They scattered and dispersed because Jesus was still dead. And so therefore, the hope that I have in Christ Jesus, the hope that I have is that he got up. And not only he got up, he declared all power. Yeah. And not only did he get up, he kept his promise because he began to tell us, he said, I got to go. In other words, when I go, I will come again and receive you back into myself. How do I come back? It's called a comforter. It's the Holy Ghost whom the Father will send in my name. Saints of God, be ready to give the reason of hope that lies within. That's why Peter can say this thing, because he had a testimony. The enemy of your soul, he wants to steal your testimony. The enemy of your soul wants you to stop talking about Jesus. The enemy of your soul wants you to stagger at the promises of God. But I want you to realize, yeah, we fall short sometimes. Yes, we will. But a saint of God, he'll repent and he'll get up. He'll repent and he'll say, God, I'm sorry. And he'll offend the saints of God. He'll go back to them before he comes to this altar. And he'll go back to his brother and say, brother, if I offended you in any kind of way, you can tell him, I'm sorry. Glory be to